If you're not listening to the Bear at Night podcast by my good buddy, Jurassic Parker, then you're gonna have to deal with me. I'm such a joy to be around. Also, I will kill you if you don't tune in right this second. This is your old pal, Joker. Or Jack White. It's what my mother called me. Before, you know what, never mind.
You're now listening to BearatNight Podcast with your host, Jurassic Parker.
All right, we are here. Thank you, everybody. This is your host, Dom, and this is the BearatNight Podcast. I have here a, how can I say, a dope cosplayer. I've been looking at it. I couldn't wait to do a cosplay interview for a while. Like, that's my bread and butter. That's my thing. That's what I love to do. That's what I love most. So, before I say his name, I just have to say, you know, seeing this guy, you know, because you're going to see him or if you're watching it or hearing the audio, literally came in a flash, no pun intended. Because I was just happy to just, I think I saw you on my For You page. And I think that's how I saw it. That's what it came through. And I was just like, who is this black guy? It's a flash. Like, hold up. What's the suit? Like, what is going on? And then I happen to look, and I'm checking this guy out, like, okay, this suit is badass. This is a badass suit right here. And somebody who, you know, I personally did Zoom for the CW Flash a few years ago and loved it. And I'm just seeing this suit, and I'm like, one, how did he get it? How did he make it? Or, like, how many hours? I'm trying to know all the details, everything, trying to figure it out. And I'm like, okay, I want to talk about the Flash. And I'm like, you know what? If I want to talk about the Flash movie and talk about a little review, I gotta have this Flash cosplay on here. I gotta have him. So here he is, Mr. Wallace Morris, Flash himself. Thank you, thank you for joining the BearatNight podcast. I really appreciate you for coming through.
Thank you, all the way from
Canada.
Yeah, I'm from Montreal, Canada, and honestly, yo, bro, I never heard so much good things about my cosplay than now. Honestly, yo, thank you. There's a lot of work, hard, like good and hard times, sweat, working hard on their costumes, but what you said is blessed. Thank you very much. I'm really grateful of being here tonight, and I check your podcast, bro. This is some good stuff. This honestly, I'm loving it, and I've looked the cast, the guests that you had. It's so much. Like I'm a geek, I'm a nerd. I see some Power Rangers stuff, and I'm a big Power Rangers fan. So
yeah,
I'm like, wow, you had a lot of them at your podcast. Yo, honestly, shout out to you first. Shout out to you for doing this.
Thank you. You know what? When somebody say like that, you know, put things in perspective like that. I don't really think, you know, and I was just telling a friend of mine earlier, and I was just like, yeah, I got two interviews today. You know, I can't wait to get them done and just, you know, and get that out there and, you know, just chop it up with these guys. And I've been looking for, I was talking about, you know, chopping up with you for like, well, since last week, well, we got to confirm to do it. Yeah. And, you know, and I was just like, my whole thing with this show was not just trying to be myself and put out all the people I find interesting that's doing something fun, cool, and positive. And I've seen what you've been doing, and, like, you got people smiling, you know, like, I'm watching a video that you put out, and I was like, this dude, like, being a cosplayer is hard sometimes. being a person of color as a cosplayer is sometimes even harder. And I'm being someone who has cosplayed Thor, I've done Green Arrow, a few different characters that are mainly not black. And, you know, hearing they're like, oh, so you're a black Thor? You're like, no, I'm just Thor. Why can't I just be Thor? But the kids see you, and they all they see is that. They don't see the color. It's as the adults see it, whatever. But to see that interaction, which you have, and I'm like, that's just like what I had. You know, I had that same interaction with people. They see the costume. All they see is the hero. They don't see the color. And I'm like, this dude is killing it right now. Like, I'm like, how have I not known of this person? Like, and I'm trying to be up on. I try to be up to date with all my my black cosplayers out here. Just like, wait, hold up, like. This guy is really doing something. And then come to find out you're in Canada, that would be like, no wonder he's hiding. That's why he's hiding. He's in Canada hiding. You know?
I just kind of looked at every cosplayer around the world and I'm like, yo, I'm in Canada and no one is representing the Flash. So why don't I represent the Flash? But there's more into being a Flash cosplayer. So man. I like now, what you're saying.
I mean, dude, you're doing a great, you're like the like my boy say, you know, the great Kevin Smith, you're doing the Lord's work. Oh, you know, you're doing the Lord's work. That's what you're doing. And dude, you know, from the helmet to the suit, like that's a little bit of like the painstakingly strategic, like the details that you had to do with, you know, making the suit pop more, you know, from what you got it. And that's just, you know, a testament to your, you know, artistry of like wanting better. You're like, you saw it, like, this is cool, but I could do better, you know, and it shows. And the finished product really pops off. It's like, that was the vision that you had, and that's what it looks like. And I'm like, dude, you killed it. You killed it. Like, how long did it take for you to do those little details?
The puffy paint was...
Yeah, the puffy paint.
The puffy paint was in a 2 weeks, like, nonstop straight. Coming out of the job, the work. I have a little daughter. I have a little kid, a little daughter. So it was putting her to bed, working on a suit as much as I can. My wife was helping me. So 2 weeks in a row before the premiere in Toronto. So it was nonstop. Even I've missed some parts. I actually, the suit is like 99.5% complete with puffy paint. I've noticed that I still have some spots that I have to work on for my Montreal Comic Con. So it's still not complete, but it was the best thing I've done for a Flash costume is the puffy paint. And I was scared, like really scared to start doing puffy paint, but the result is magnificent. And this is what you said. I killed it. The suit is it's popping out. And seeing the movie now, it was worth it.
Yes. Yes, because you know what? When I did watch the movie, and we go get into that, I thought about your suit. I did. I thought about, you know, the differences between yours and watching the suit, like, this, you know, in the movie. And, you know, seeing how you did yours and watching the suit, I liked your suit better. I like his suit only when it glowed, like when he's going through the Speed Force. Like, when it was by itself, it just seemed dull to me. Maybe because I'm just so, you know, in the world of the Arrowverse and see the Grant Gustin's Flash suits.
And then we see the yellow. Years.
Yeah, you know, you see all those different suits versions in it. And I love those suits, you know, especially all the way to now when he actually has, you know, put on the actual full body suit. And I'm like, I'm doing the comparison. And I'm like, yours look way more comfortable. Like, you're way more comfortable, actually, I would say, too.
That was a point. That was a point. For all the costume that I've made about the Flash, this one needed to be the most comfortable because I've learned from my mistakes, and I wanted to have it like I feel like I could fly, jump, roll down, anything. And comfort was my first issue with most of the other suits. So this one was the main point: be comfy.
Yeah, I say that to a lot of cosplayers, especially newer ones coming into the game. I learned over the years, comfortability is the key. You know, making sure you have the comfortable shoes, make sure, you know, because sometimes you're going to be in that outfit for a good amount of time, and you want to be comfortable. You know, you want to make sure that the material that you're going to get is not too hot, you know. You know, I gradually went from being doing the whole two-piece suit, whatever, like the Green Arrow and stuff, and really being hot as balls in that suit. Just like after going outside in the heat, and then coming inside, and, you know, air conditioning, and you know all that stuff. And it's just, you know, it's just that pleather. It's like after a while, it feels heavy.
Oh, I feel you, brother. I feel you.
Oh gosh, you know, it's just like no, and then. As a matter of fact, I just talk about the Flash. I did Zoom, and I don't know where my cow is for Zoom, and that was like a heavy material, whatever that, you know, the stuff that the guy used, it was hot. And I remember having to go and do it outside, pictures and stuff, barely breathing because of the slits in the mouth that he has, and it's just like. I can barely turn my head. I'm doing the Batman's turn with the neck every time.
Yeah, like in the movie.
I couldn't do what I want to do. I'm like, this is torture. Like, I was dying every time. And then after a while, like I said, the suit got hot. But seeing like how you got to wear the full bodysuit, I like, dang, he's comfortable. He's chilling. Yeah, he's chilling right there. Like he's cool when he needs to be cool. He's going through all the temperature changes and he's fine. Like, you know, the only uncomfortable thing I would say on that, I would think, is probably the helmet. If you want to take it off,
even the helmet, the way I know it's part of a 3D model, but with the magnets, I made it comfortable so I can take it off and also not have to sweat that much. So I have a cowl under. The helmet.
Yes.
And I think, well, this might not be my most comfortable helmet. It's the one from the Injustice 2 Flash. But I felt great having it, just putting it and then having to move and then nothing is popping out or just breaking. Mm. So, sweat a bit, but I know all the little extra stuff that I've worked to make it worth it.
Right.
So.
And how long did it take for you to print that, the helmet? How long did it take?
Well, I asked someone commissioned while we had a pandemic to work on the helmet.
Oh, wow.
From the first teaser of DC fandom, The Flash.
Wow.
I saw the helmet. I took some photos and then do 3D print. Had a file, so got a commission, and then it took maybe 6 months, maybe a year, just to make it clean. And that was the first version, and then I made the upgrades. And to this, to now, this is one of the nicest helmet I had, honestly.
The paint job is really slick.
Oh, yeah. The guy who did it, shout out to Dweeb Creation Details. He did my Speed Force helmet from Injustice 2 and this one. Okay. So this is like top notch and also unique. There's like not two of them. There's only one of them. That's
right.
Yeah.
I would say like, thank God for 3D printers, man. Like,
oh yeah.
You know, I would say it has helped everyone take their talents to a different level. You know, before you had to like, if you want certain things made, you have to do it overseas or not. Or whatnot, but now one of my best friends, he has a 3D printer, and I could just go like right now. I'm having him make me a helmet right now for my Phantom cosplay. Yeah. So it's like just to be like, hey, okay, these are the dimensions, this is the size, whatever. And he's like, okay, it'll be done in another, you know, a few days or whatnot. But just be like, to know I could just hop over his house and he can just, hey, can you come over? I need you to just size the helmet out really quick just so we can see where we at. Exactly. You know, it's a process. It's a process, mm-hmm. but at the same time, this is like these upgrades that we didn't have like at least 10 years ago, five to 10 years ago. So,
I'm still using EVA foam. And some of my Flash costume, even if I know there's 3D printers going around, right. I still go with EVA foam because I feel that it is more, how would I say it? Practical for some costume because right. the armor piece is fine. But if I need to move, especially as a speedster, I need something that I can move, flexible, I can bend.
Yeah.
Exactly. So still, EVA foam is my go-to. And then if it's something more hard, let's go 3D print.
Right. I totally agree with you with that. And that my apartment is too small for me to mess around with EVA foam. I can try, but I don't think it's... It's something I don't think I have mastered to be like, I got this. You know, like, making props, I got that. I can make props, paint some stuff, you know. But when it comes to the EVA foam, I don't think I'm that talented. I can make some stuff out of something, you know. But when it comes to that other stuff, like, I wanted to make a Green Ranger shield one day. And my friend was like, yeah. You can do it. I'm like, how about you just do it for me? Can you how about I just give you some money and you just do it for me? Okay.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think I got the time for it. I don't have it. I don't have it in me. But it's a testament. And it's funny because you were saying earlier about, you know, you see some of the parts that you missed or whatnot with the puppy paint. And I swear that is probably just what you, that's what you see. You know, the artist in you, the creator in you. That's what you see. Other people, they don't even see that. The regular average person doesn't even see that at all. You look at your suit like, no, I'm missing that. I'm missing this here right there. You literally have to point it out to somebody for them to understand what you're talking about. Because they just look at the overall masterpiece of it. And you're like, no, it's not ready yet. I'm not done yet. I'm not there. Yeah,
but you know what?
At
the same time, these parts that it's not completed are strategic parts. It's under mm-hmm. the armpit, under the yes. crouch. Okay. So people won't even see it, even if I know. So you're right. Right. So this is me as the artist going,
dude,
it happens.
It happens. Mm-hmm. I just, as a cosplayer, the artist of me just like I realized I never knew until like most recently that there was a black gorilla glue. I mean black hot glue.
Hot glue, yeah.
I didn't even know it was black hot glue. I freaked out. I was like, this could have saved me so much time with other stuff. Because I had to do little minor repairs and whatnot. But then I had to color in with the black paint. I'm like, this is going to save me so much trouble over the years and stuff.
Oh, yeah. The thing you learn from listening to other cosplayers and saying, I never knew. And my go-to right now for patching and doing stuff is epoxy. And dollar store has epoxy. You mix it up together and your stuff is glued. That you cannot pull it out. So I'm like, wow, if I knew that, like all the convention outside with the hot weather,
right?
I wouldn't have that to wear and keep my belt or my helmet in my hand. Or this is something, like you said, maybe a few years ago, I would have been good.
Yeah, it's one of those things that like, I was thinking for cosplaying and, you know, it's always a learning process. You always learn new things as you go along and, you know, and it helps you be better at it and stuff. How long have you been cosplaying?
It has been over 10 years. Wow. And it's 10 years of not making a statement about being a cosplayer, but especially being a Flash cosplayer. Because I've started when I saw some people around the world, Philippines and I think Washington, D.C., they were right. cosplaying the Flash. And they were the first really pushing on social medias. And I'm right. like, yo, man, I want to do it. I love the Flash. Let me do it. And I started doing my costume. And then every time I was cosplaying, it was, oh, you're a Wally West. Oh, you're a Black Flash.
Yeah. I'm like, yeah.
Yeah, oh, yeah, just a Flash cosplayer. So, and then that was the process too. But over 10 years, I never thought that I would go this far about being the Flash. So I'm grateful that for people for saying that I'm their Flash. You're the Flash, man. If I see you or I have to see who's the Flash cosplayer, this is you. So 10 years right. working hard, and then I'm grateful because I have a lot of friends, fans that are supporting me. And yeah, let's see where it goes after 10 years.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful, bro. I you know, it's funny because you get those moments where it's like they always, if you're trying to be this character that's perceived originally as a white person, a white character, but then you're trying to be this character, you're trying to portray, you know, they're always gonna get that. So you're the Black Flash, or you're Wally, or because they just assume a lot of times. But if you say, oh, I'm Barry Allen, I'm Barry Allen's Flash, they're like, ah, wait, but he's not Black. Like you know, that's the thing. And he's like, no, he's also not a real person either. So it's like, what's the limitations here? You know, there should be no limitations. And I get it, because I was trying to be a Thor cosplayer, Bailey, when I first started. And it was a big thing, a big deal for me. And a lot of people liked it and stuff. And then it was funny because out of all the people that liked my cosplay that wanted to take pictures, it was one person that stood out that messed me up. And it was this lady who's like, I thought Thor was white. So are you a Black Thor? Like, how's that? And it messed me up because I was like, why you gotta ruin my day with this? Do you think? Yeah, but that was the
comment was not necessary, especially if you're in a convention and then you see that everyone portraying their favorite characters, and that person comes out at you and say, "Man, I thought Thor was white." I don't understand. Is there any rule saying that Thor could not be Black? So that is an issue that has come, and still, when the movie came a few weeks ago, I see a lot. Oh, Flash, Black Flash.
Yeah. Wow.
Black Flash. Like, Wally West has portrayed Flash on CW. Like, Keenan Lonsdale put the Flash suit for season 4, episode 1. He was the Flash at that moment. It wasn't called back Black Flash. He was the Flash. So that thing is like, man, this doesn't matter. You see the lightning bolt on the chest, you're Flash.
That's how I look at it. Like, I remember I did Cyclops from X-Men. And I loved it. I saw it from a DeviantArt Photoshop. And I'm like, oh, this is dope. And I worked my butt off to get it to define, you know, to be exactly how I saw this artwork. And it came out great. And then somebody said, oh, so you're Bishop. I don't have a scarf. I don't have an M. I had the visor. Did you not see the visor? So you're like, oh, so you're not Bishop?
So like, disrespecting at a point, because you know Bishop is not like that. So you're just like, maybe he's a version of Cyclops / Bishop. No, he's Cyclops.
No, it's just Cyclops. I'm just Cyclops. Like, why can't I be Cyclops? Like, it was just the weird. Oh my god, it was. I've had those moments over the years, but the kids, those are the ones that I would say always make it so reassuring that you're doing good. You know, I feel like every cosplayer has that moment where they get that moment with a child, and they just like, they want to give you a hug, or they want to like take a picture with you, and it's like, you know what, this is all worth it. This is I'll take it all. This is what I've been. This is what I was made for. I was made for this moment right here. Like, this is my purpose. Like, you find your calling in that moment. It is like, because you know that you've made an impact on that child somehow, that they're gonna remember years to come. And it's like, oh yeah, I remember I was over here, and this guy was the Flash, you know, and I thought he was the real Flash, like, but not thinking anything about color, not thinking,
exactly,
like, you know, nothing, like, it's just like, oh, that he's not a real character, like, no, he was the, like, that was the Flash, just like, I believe in Santa Claus, like, that whole thing, like, yep, right up there, you know, so, you know, yeah. We all get those moments.
Yeah, because these days, if it's not the same person that you see on paper, on television, you're not the character. So
right.
Just seeing these kids saying, oh my God, he has the same costume. He looks different, but no, he's the guy because he has the same attitude. He has the same lyrics. He speaks the same way. And ask him a question, he will answer the way the character responds. So this is
almost like going to Disney. You see the people dress up. They're those characters. They're not pretending. They are the characters.
Exactly.
That's how you got to be sometimes. You just be that character. Like, just like if you go to a con and you see a bunch of Deadpools everywhere, they're going to be a Deadpool. They're going to be acting just like Deadpool. Annoying as they might be.
Fun facts. I went to another convention and then there was a lot of cosplayer.
Right.
DC, Marvel, and then there was a bunch of kids that didn't know how to present themselves to the cosplayer for photos. Right. So every cosplayer that was there forgot about the kids. They were so into their costume and social media stuff that the kids were afraid of asking. And then I'm in a corner and I'm seeing one of the kid with a Flash t-shirt, and I see there's a bunch of Flash. And I'm like, you know what? He's looking at me and he wants a photo. Let me just run to him and make his day. So I'm like running and like, hey, how's it going? What's your name? I'm the Flash. What you want a picture? Show it to your boys at school and say that you saw the Flash. And then his eyes just popped. He had a smile. Her mom or his dad was so happy to thank you very much. And then this is how you said. The kids, don't forget about them, because we are so into our costume. We work so hard, but the kids that will come to you, this is the one that will make your day. So I'm so into it. I'm so into that. And until I'm done with cosplay, they are my first audience. That's for sure.
I always think, I always tell people, if you want to do something fun, try cosplaying one day. And see how much of a difference it will be for you by the end of the day. I had one of my best friends, his girlfriend, now wife, she dressed up as Shuri, you know, and he did Black Panther, she did Shuri, and she was never into the video games and all that when they got together, and she was not into cosplay and everything. The first time she actually did, she's like, you know what, all right, we'll do it. She loved it. And the amount of kids, you should have seen her face of her interactions with these kids. It was like she's been doing this forever, but she just fell in line with it. She was Shuri, like, and these kids, these little girls kept coming to her, taking a picture. And she was into it. I had to tell my best friend, like, dude, she's killing it. Look at her. She didn't even want to do this at first. She was scared. She was nervous. But she's doing this, like, she's been doing it for ages, and that's just like the little power that the kids bring out of you, like that little extra oomph, you know. My other friend, my best friend, he did Black Panther. We're at a casino. There was a table full of little white kids for a birthday party. They saw him and freaked out because he was the Black Panther and wanted to take pictures, and they were so hyped. And I didn't even feel, I was like hyped for him because I'm like, this is the effect that he's doing to these kids as a cosplayer. Like, he's portraying the character. He was, you know, Wakanda forever, the whole night. Oh, just doing it. You know, so I, you know, the kids is every, I, the kids is the number one thing for me when it comes to cosplay. And, you know, and I hope for everybody, you know, for whoever does cosplay, either still doing it or wants to do it later in the future, you know, the kids is where it's at. Like, the negative stuff always comes from, like, somebody, like, adults, you know. But the kids, those are the ones that make it worthwhile the whole way. So now we talked about The Flash. You saw the movie.
Yes.
And spoiler alert for anybody who's going to see this part, because it's been a couple weeks now.
Already?
You didn't see it? It's been a couple weeks. So, and by the time I put this out, probably you will see. By the time I put, when I put this out, it will be tomorrow.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, y'all got enough time. Y'all got enough time to watch this movie. So, spoiler alert. What did you think about this movie? You got to see it first.
Honestly, being a Flash fan aside, that movie is a great movie for entertaining. Not right. That is copy-paste from Flashborn comics. No. Watching it, and I've watched it 4 times already.
Wow.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Like, this is the fan in me, but also it's the first time we see the Flash on big screen. So it is entertaining, colorful.
Right.
Having Keaton back to add in the suit, that was, wow, incredible. Not going to lie, some special effects are not the best. But me seeing the Flash, the suit, and how he rises to be who he is in the comics,
right?
It's a good version. It's a good version of Flashpoint. I liked it. So There's some ups, down, fail, miss opportunities, but I would still watch it again and again because
right. It
was entertaining. That's the thing. It was. If there were nothing else, I'm not sure.
I get you. It definitely was entertaining. There was entertainment, yes. There was a lot of those, and I agree with you with that. The effects, I was questionable with a lot of things. I know there was like the rumblings about the whole thing when he's in the Speed Force.
Yeah, incredible.
And I kind of like the whole arena style thing. That was kind of cool. Gave me something different, you know, and I could take the director was talking about how he wanted to make the look of the effects, so it was supposed to look.
Yeah, but the Speed Force, we kind of had a glimpse of the Speed Force, and then we went into the Chrono Ball, so it was two different things. That's the missing part.
Yeah, and like the main thing was like for me when like the first few minutes of it. You know, seeing the babies, and I'm like, oh no, that baby looked dead. What is wrong with that baby right there? Like, it was like maybe like two of them that I saw that looked real, and I'm like, oh no, this is all CGI. But it's like, man, I think the CW could have did better with the CGI with that baby. Like, you know, you
mentioned this to CW, and I think I forgot to mention it in another podcast or when I was speaking to my brothers. This is kind of a, I would say, high hand, more budget CW version slash movie, because they had mistakes everywhere in the movie that looks like the CW, but it was a more budget version of the CW. So I'm like,
yeah. And the thing is with the CW, you're expecting some things not to look all right. I mean, not to be all the way, because it's the CW. They don't have a big budget, but I mean, then again, they did really good with Gorilla Grodd and King Shark.
Oh yeah,
you know, they really did. I really enjoyed those. But then I see this, who are on a higher pay scale with their effects, and I'm like, why does this look like this? I don't understand. I mean, I feel bad for the people behind the scenes because I know they've been working like, the horror stories right now.
They've been rushing.
Yeah, a lot of rushing. So you're not going to get the fine stuff now because everybody wants all this cool special effects. And it's not enough people. You know, like, I think I think it was I forgot what movie had like damn near like 10 studios doing effects for this. Oh, like I think it was Across the Spider-Verse had like 10 different studios doing the effects for this stuff, which kind of shows, but also it came out really great. But this right here is just like, man, I don't know about this, these babies. And did he cook this baby in the microwave? Like, I don't understand this. I didn't care too much about... Yeah, because it popped off. It rang, and I'm like, oh, no, he cooked the baby. You know, it was some funny parts, and, you know, the whole thing was him having to eat to, you know, get his speed together, which is kind of funny, but I felt like they kind of overdid a little bit of it. But then again, I'm being biased because, you know, Flash, the CW, they talked about that, and then it just ended in, oh, we made special bars for you. You know, candy bars, so you can eat. Okay, end of that discussion. We don't have to worry about that ever again in the rest of the shows. My main gripe with the Ezra Miller Flash, and, you know, and I'm not even thinking about the crazy stuff that happened outside of the movie stuff, which is crazy and just wild, is ever since I saw him in Justice League, his run. His run has always irked me. It has always, deep down in my core, just made me feel some type of way. And I was like, that's not how you're supposed to run. That's not how you do it.
Yeah, like, Justice League, that was the worst.
Yeah, and I feel like how some people had their, like, that's not how you're supposed to fly, like, in certain Supermans. In the past, like, that person don't know how to fly.
I know, like, Christopher it was Reeves supposed to be fly. As an ice. Yeah, it was supposed to be like he's ice skating, moving. Like, it was based on that. So we kind of know after the movie got released that he based his running on ice skaters. But even though in the new movie they fix it, but really at the end, that's the only part that you're seeing him running is at the end. And this is a short scene.
You're right about that. And this, you had to wait all the way to the end. You had to suffer the whole way to that part. And it was funny because it showed him running in that moment when he's running. and he just went out the special effects. And like, see? He looks goofy. Doesn't he look goofy? I'm like, this is what I've been talking about. Take the effects away. That's how he's running. It looks stupid.
Exactly. That was one of the best moments. I'm slow.
and I've been saying this. I stand by it. You give me Grant Gustin and his running and put it with that special effects with all that money they put in the effects. Don't get me wrong. It's beautiful. The running. You know how they do the whole running thing with him. But you give me Grant Gustin and put him in that. Oh, it's gonna be looking. It's gonna be marvelous.
Probably. I don't know. But I would love to see a professional ice skater put on a Flash cosplay suit, go on the ice, and do the thing. And let's see if it looks goofy or not.
I think it would probably look better than Greg, better than Ezra Miller.
Probably
his arms. Yeah. His arms, bro.
Maybe not the legs. But it's probably the arm. Yeah, mostly the arm. And that's
like the orangutan arms is going everywhere. He reminds me of the inflatable tube man at a car dealership, just wringing all over the place. That's what he reminds me of. And I'm just like, I hate how he runs. This is horrible. I did like certain, like, you know, they did, because we've done Flashpoint so much now, but I like how they switch things around. And I was telling somebody yesterday, this is the first time I ever got to see Michael Keaton as Batman in a movie theater. Because every time I've seen him before, I was a kid. I was, you know, the first one was 89. I was so young. I was born in 85. So it was like, no, I'm not going to think of it. Same. The other one was 92. I was a child. I was a little kid. Still didn't get to see the movie. I had to wait till it came out on VHS, you know, to see any of one of those. So to see him as Batman now was a big deal, I say. You know, and the marketing sure they did it for me too. And just to see Michael Keaton as Batman, like, this time it's like, it did something to my heart. It was like, oh my god, this is Batman. This is my Batman.
Yeah,
that was definitely cool.
Mm-hmm,
that
mm-hmm.
was so cool.
I feel you, because even when he dropped the I'm Batman, I'm like, oh wow. Yeah. You see it on the big screen, it's like, my god, I've been watching Batman 89 just a few weeks ago, 1992, and then you see him say the same said, oh my god, the suit, the whole thing. Man, yeah.
Oh, wait, what was that? How much does she weigh?
I'm
like, what one? That's just, it shouldn't even matter how much she weighs. Let's just get out of here, but still. Like she's a twig right now.
He had to check with his gadgets if it worked.
Yeah, I love that he had his gadgets, but they worked, but they were out of date. And it was just like he had a beeper. And I was like, oh my god, he has a beeper! Like, and they pointed it out. It was like, these are all cool gadgets that was cool back then.
If you remember. In the first Batman, the kind of computers that they had was like the old computers. Yeah. And then looking at the Flash, you see they have laptops, they have cell phone, like recent models. So is it our Batman, the one that we know from 89, or this is another version that never grew with technology and then just stuck with what he had? Like, because even the Batcave
give up.
Yeah, he gave up because even the Batcave wasn't up to date.
No. It was stuck in his own time bubble. And I will say, like, if your Batmobile has been sitting there for that god amount of years, shouldn't you need to check the engine, make sure everything's still running, and every now and then, like,
that's why they didn't use it in the movie.
Yeah, it's also funny. I realized as an adult, see how cool the Batcave is. It's a lot of health, death hazards there, because where the Batmobile is standing at, it sits at. It's like it's no edge. There's no bars around to make sure you don't fall off.
There's a pit.
Yes, there's a pit there. You could die. If you drive too fast, you hit the brakes too hard, or you don't do it too hard, you can just hit the whole Batmobile just falls in.
Mm-hmm.
Like, exactly. How many other Batmobiles are down there, just messed up? That's how I don't know. seeing Supergirl, I love what they did with this character.
I'm not disappointed of seeing Supergirl. And in fact, really? That since I knew from the beginning that was in the Flashpoint that we know,
right?
Bringing that Supergirl, especially now, it is an open door for a Supergirl cameo, team up, crossover, but especially bringing her version into our DCU universe, because I don't know if it's going to be her Supergirl, Girl of Tomorrow, or it's going to be someone, because we still have the issue that it's like cosplay. She is not blonde. Do we have to keep her? Do we have to modify this universe? So that thing is, but it was cool seeing a Supergirl on the big screen, like Ellen Slater was back then.
Yes, and the Helen Slater one is like one of those so bad is good movies for me.
I have the DVD and I loved it.
I still think even seeing her in the Arrowverse Supergirl was like a big deal. Like, I love those little Easter egg actors they put in, even like Wesley Chip. In the Flash as Jim Garrett or his dad, that's my Flash. That's my Flash right there. Like, I love Grant Gustin, but seeing the original Flash in the show was my guy.
I spoke to him. I spoke to John Wesley Shipp. It was amazing, honestly. Seeing him and talking to him was like you, he's my Flash. So,
yeah, I told him I when I got to meet him, because I remember it was a con and he was the only person I wanted to meet, and I was like, I have to meet him, I gotta meet him. He's the one I want to see, and I told him hands down, he was the only reason why I watched Dawson's Creek. I told him, and I cried real tears, and you died on that show. And he was like, I don't know whether he was sad, like surprised that a grown black man of myself was watching Dawson's Creek as a kid, or that I cried that, you know, because I looked at him as a father figure too. Like, you know, I took my TV watching very serious, mm-hmm. you know, as a kid, and you know, and I told him like, yo, when you died on that show, I was hurt, like I was distraught. You know, and then I just see you die again on the Flash. He's like, I can't take this.
Oh, yo, man. he actually died three times in the Flash.
God, yeah. Yes, that's right. Yeah, as Jay Garrett. God damn.
Henry Halland.
And then the Flash again.
Yeah.
Yes, and God, he looks so good in that old suit, man. Like.
It was the best suit ever, man. To be honest, if the movie has the Flash movie has a beautiful suit, I love the effects of the suit.
Yes, boots. Yeah.
Well, I have a version of it. But that suit on the big screen, I would have been screaming on the big screen, seeing him as a cameo, and then seeing him back, that would be crazy.
I recently, because a couple weeks ago, my internet was out, and I had to wait. So I got it back on. So I took that time to watch the Flash series, the original one. Because I bought it years ago on, you know, from Walmart. I had it, it was on sale, but the, you know.
Yeah.
And I just to watch it all over again and just see that suit, it's like, damn, that suit still holds up, man. That's a badass suit. That's a badass suit right there.
And
it even, even they updated it for the new, for CW. For
CW one.
And it was still beautiful. Jesus.
Yeah, like, you know, we're now having suit with texture, pattern. But
right.
At that time, it was a flat red suit with a little bit of shading with muscles. And it looks good. It looks amazing.
Well, and it was also some type of felt type of material. Because
yes,
I do know he was sweating a lot.
Yeah,
he was sweating a lot. He lost pounds a lot of times he was wearing that suit. And he only made, like, maybe a hero suit. They made two suits and a third suit for the stuntman. So it was like, it stank, he said. It started to break after a while.
He ripped the hair pieces at the end when it was over.
Yeah. You know, but like I said, like, that suit still holds up to me as, like, one of the best suits. Especially at that time, everything was black. You know, and they took a chance and like, no, he's the Speedster, he's the Scarlet Speedster. We got to do it the right way, and he did. Until we got to the Grant Gustin suits and whatnot, and we had some hit and misses there. I would say the
Grant Gustin suits.
But I still love. Is that the one with the weird cow? Yes.
Yeah.
The suit was fine. I like the suit here. The cow, and it just messed me up, especially when Stephen Amell had to wear it.
Yeah, what happened? Man. What happened? Why this cow? I don't understand how they decided to make a cow that looks like I don't know. It didn't felt like the Flash. It felt like a cosplay. A guy wearing a cosplay of the Flash, missing the jaw piece.
It's because I'm like, can you bring the chin back? Can we bring the chin strap, please? And, you know, but I did. It's funny because I watched some of the older episodes of CW Flash, and I missed the old way of just like, he's taking off the helmet. I mean, he's taking off the cowl, but it's like that little switch where he's just like a little hood. But you just see, it's that little trick, those camera trick of you look at the other person, come back, it's on the side, you know? Like,
yeah.
And then they made everything nano. Everything was nanotech. And I like, that's cool and all, but I want to see him just put it over, like, yeah, no, just give me that. I don't mind.
Arrow, like Green Arrow, like he wears the cowl, the hood, and then putting him back.
yeah, somehow the mask is gone. You know, it's gone. Like, there's no eye paint. Trust me, I don't know how he would do that. Because you got to put all the eye paint on, then you put the mask on, and then you got to put the hood. Man, I was sweating. But it's a fun suit, you know. But yeah, I don't know how you just do it every time like that. But with this suit right here, for Ezra Miller, I didn't mind it. Like I said, I liked it when he's going through the Speed Force. Like it started glowing. I like that, and I love the ring. I love that flash ring. Like that, I think that's the best part of the whole suit for me. It's the flash ring. Like, I love what they did with it.
It well represented the ring, because we had that comic book version, and how would you like to open it? Let me make it open it on side. That was well thing.
Yeah. Yes. It was definitely a dope. It's definitely a dope ring. Honestly, it's like, dang, he really killed this with this ring. It's right up there with the Green Lantern ring they did for the movie. I'm like, dang, this is a badass ring. You know, can we just make it function like the real one? That's all. But with the Ezra Miller's character, how do you feel about his acting as Flash?
The acting was different from what I was expecting. The fact that we know he was playing two different Barry Allen, a younger version.
Which he did really well.
He did well.
Yeah.
Because we saw some grounded Ezra Miller Barry Allen, and then someone who's goofy, a bit like what we had in Justice League, but the changing. We know there's so many movies out there that has one actor doing different personalities. Yeah. So this one was really well done, and I didn't felt it was Ezra. I felt like, wow, Barry is speaking to Barry, but a much younger version. And then I didn't felt that goofy line coming out of him, and it's the emotion. I believed him, and nothing against. I know that his performance in Fantastic Beasts wasn't the best.
Right.
So looking at him right now, I'm like, I hope it's not the same. And then it gave me a well and not Oscar performance, but a good one that I would say, man, he's a good actor.
Yeah, I was never really keen on his acting too much. Like, I've heard he's good here and good there, but to see him go from being goofy until the moment he had to meet himself and realize, this is what everybody's been talking about. Oh, I will really punch myself. Like that's how he felt. And in that moment, out of the two, he had to grow up for the both of them to get the things done. And it was like that. I was like, okay, he's killing it. But also, we've come a long way from doing the same actor playing two characters. You know, the split screen thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's come a long way. Before, you can even touch the other, the other person, if you're doing a split screen character of the same guy. But it's so good now. All you have to do is they put the little dots on the face and whatnot, and you know, have somebody look close to the actor, and then it's just doing the post. But it's just like, God, it really made me feel like it was two actors playing, you know, in this role, and not thinking it's just one person, it's them both.
Yeah,
you know, so that's. Yeah. As a testament to him, you know, and I mean, yeah, he did well. Grant Gustin got the better cry, though. I'm just saying, but I feel the pain when he cries. That's all I'm saying.
They have their different strength and also weakness. If I have to go with Grant. Grant has the look of Barry Allen Flash. I would say mostly Barry Allen. And Ezra has the Flash look. That's what I had in mind. He has the Flash
even
look.
Though neither one of them are blind. Yes. They're supposed to be blind. Neither one of them are blind.
But there's an interview that he had Grant Gustin in. He proposed the blonde hair. And yes, Mark Guggenheim said, yeah, you saw it? And he said, nah, you're going to kill yourself. Like, if you do bleaching your hair every day, it's not, don't stay brown. Stay
well, that, well, that's what Michael Rosenbaum had said about him playing Lex Luthor on Smallville. He was cool with the role at first, but then every year he had to cut his hair, you know, go bald every time when he just didn't want to do it. But it's part of the role. He has to. So, you know, he had to shave his head every time. He just, after a while, he got tired of shaving his head. That's when he, like, basically left the show after a while, you know. He was happy when it was over. He's like, I don't have to shave my head no more.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, sometimes you'd be ready for it in the beginning to fit the part, but then after a while, he's like, yeah, I got to be committed to this. You know, I think that's even when, like, when, what's the name, who had to play Mystique in the latest franchise of the
Rebecca Roman Stamos.
No, not Rebecca.
Jennifer Lawrence?
Jennifer Lawrence, you know, because she signed on in the beginning, yeah, I'm going to do all the makeup. But then as her star power got bigger, you start seeing her less and less as Mystique in the movies because she's like, hey, I'm not doing all that makeup. I don't want to.
Yeah.
I'm a star now. I don't have to. You know, so, you know, sometimes you get you done with doing that.
And you they know, forget from, the fans. They forget the fans.
Yeah, so, you know, people, you know, you have changes. So, when it comes to, there was a part in the movie that surprised, that bothered me in there. And I don't know if you noticed it, if you really caught on. But they were in the apartment, right? Spoiler alert for everybody still. They're in an apartment, in Barry's apartment, and they're going back and forth with the powers and stuff. And he's phasing downstairs and stuff and, you know, messing up everything. But the next day, or that morning, there's a guy on the couch who's apparently been sleeping on that couch for the whole time. And Patty, I believe it's Patty Spivot, who's in the comic.
It's her.
Yes, and her boyfriend in the car, who's a TikToker, a guy I know from, like, I follow on Instagram and stuff. Seeing them in the other room, and I'm like, wait, they've been in here the whole time this was going on?
Well, there's one thing that you can notice before going to the morning of that scene is when they come into the apartment, there's a shot that you see the bed, and the bed has some bumping. You don't know if there's someone into the bed, but you see there's a bump. And I, because I've seen it four times, I'm like, okay, these details are bugging me. And then the guy on the couch wasn't there. That's one miss. But the bumping on the bed, I'm like, maybe they're under the they're doing something, but they were there, I think.
Yeah, so I thought that was something else. Like, I thought it was funny, especially the guy on the couch. He was like, well, you have this bum guy on the couch. You've been here the whole time sleeping? Like,
yeah,
I don't get that. But, I mean, it's whatever. I guess you want to have a funny moment. It's fine. I was going to say, like, the Supergirl, I thought she was great. She's totally hot. I like the haircut. The suit is amazing. The suit was really amazing to me.
10 out of 10.
Yes, the suit was beautiful. Gosh, they killed it with that suit. The Michael Keaton being there, it really made me want to see the Batgirl movie that they finished. But they did, I mean, I guess it's finished and it's edited. But it really made me like, oh, okay, so we got this moment with Michael Keaton. But now I know we can have another moment with him in that suit. But who knows if we'll ever see the movie?
Yeah. The thing is, we're not producer, we're not executives of big companies. But for us, watching that movie, even if it's a flop, we'll buy it. We'll buy a ticket. We'll see it, and then you'll make money on it. It'll be a growth money for you. And then you teased us for so many years about Batgirl and Batman coming back. So I hope there's someone who will just leak that film and then we can watch it. Oh, yeah. Because there were Brendan Fraser in the movie, Michael Keaton. And
oh, my God, yes. He's a Firefly.
Fireflies.
And it looks cool, too. The suit, his outfit looks really cool.
Yeah, that's the thing. And then you got a whole cast that are great actors, and then you're not delivering it to the fans.
And I think you would think it would be like a good idea too, because Brendan Fraser just won the Academy Award, you know, for his one movie. So it's like, this is part of his comeback stuff, you know. Let's get more of that. Like, bring that out there. Bring, you know, Brendan Fraser. You know, and then like I said, like, you want people more to talk about, you know, Michael Keaton more. Put this movie out there so we don't have to wait until like 20 years from now for somebody to pop it up on YouTube. Or
exactly.
Like they did. What it was, like the Fantastic Four 1990s movie.
Yeah.
Somebody just posted it up. Like, I'm waiting for somebody to do that right now with this Batgirl movie. Like, because the suit didn't look too bad. It looked like someone like the comics. And I know...
It was, yeah, from the Rebirth, yeah.
Yeah. And I know she gets a little upgrade in the suit, too. So it's like, man, I want to see it. It's like a court... I think it has some Court of Owls type of thing going with it, I believe.
Yes, exactly.
God, I want to see it. You know, I want to see what happens. And, you know, who knows if we'll ever get it. But, I mean, I guess we'll have to see what they do good with Blue Beetle. So... how you feel about Blue Beetle? Are you looking to, you know?
I know.
Jaime Reyes.
I've read a few comics from Blue Beetles. I've watched animated series,
right, with
Blue Beetle in it, and I love, if a good movie has to have a good soundtrack, and then right, just the trailer just bring me a beat with the soundtrack. So. That was one thing. Actor, he's good in Cobra Kai.
Yeah, as Miguel. I love Cobra Kai.
And then seeing him as a big superhero role, I'm like, you know, he's going to nail it. And
yeah.
Oh, Easter egg, Easter egg spoiler. If anyone saw the Final Fantasy sword from Cloud, you know, it was made for fans. It was made for fans. And I know it will deliver as the Batman from Matt Reeves. Because there were so many Easter eggs in Matt Reeves' Batman that I feel this is something that will bring other fans to say, yo, you know
was
what?
Wasn't it Court Industries? And in, like, there was an actual building with Court Industries in there. So I remember that, yeah.
Yeah. That's so the hopefully... thing. There's so many Easter eggs that's like, wow, okay, this is a good movie. That's right. For, it's a fan. It's made for fans. I'm definitely going to see it. And if I can, I like to see it before the premiere and maybe meet him if he comes to Toronto. Who knows?
Yeah. That you know, and also I like about the suit, it's practical.
Yes.
Like, I'm a fan of practical effects. And if you could not make everything CGI, but actually have a real suit to draw from, and like, they don't have to do too much CGI on that suit, because the suit by itself looks gorgeous, you know. And like, it really looks good. It has that feel to it. And like, man, it kind of gave me almost like a Guyver Dark Hero vibe too.
Yes, the Guyver. You know? I felt the same thing. The Guyver, the way he comes out, and then he pops. He fights. I'm like, wow, this is the Guyver. Damn.
Yes, and kudos to you for knowing about the Guyver Dark Hero. You know, thank you. I've been preaching the gospel of Guyver Dark Hero for years.
This is a sequel, by the way, because the first one with Mark Hamill, it was a beautiful introduction, but the action is in Dark Hero.
It's so much better.
So much better. And you see it on the hill, jumping, fighting, using all the skills that we saw in the manga and also in the anime. So
yeah, the little speed up sound they use when he's kicking and everything. Oh my god. I still wanted to make another movie or something, but remake it somehow, because it's something that's like, you could do so much damage, you know, with that material. You do a lot with it. Or make it a series. You know, I'd rather make it a series or a web series, you know.
Blue Beetle was supposed to be on HBO Max or now Max as a series. So you could do the same for Guyver.
You could. And I mean, who doesn't like some weird alien technology taking over your body where you just kick ass, you know, and just, you know,
kick ass at things. Titans was a good series, so do the same.
Yeah, now that everything is over with the Arrowverse, it's a bittersweet situation. I'm glad that we had it, and I had a great time with it over the years. That we had some good times and some bad times at Arrowverse. With the new Flash, do you think, we're going to get a different Flash out of the situation now? Do you think we, because the rumblings of Grant Gustin is going to replace, Ezra Miller, something happened in the timeline where whatever happens. And I know that they did film something with Grant Gustin, but I think it was supposed to be for a cameo, but they never did it. They never put it in the movie.
I'll give you a spoiler alert. Spoiler. I'm a big collector, as I can see in the back. And yeah. One of the figures that was released by McFarlane Collectibles was the Flash Grant Gustin.
Yeah. Oh.
And it wasn't from released from the movie because there was supposed to be a cameo of Grant. And yeah. There was an action figure of the Flash from the CW that was with the box with the Flash logo on it. And it was a mistake that was released. So
I'm about to look that up.
There was one guy who found it. I'm like, oh bro. Just buy it for me and I'll get it.
Yeah.
Just tell me. So I don't mind if they replace him. If they keep him, he did a great job. If they replace him, be sure that we still got the Flash vibe when he puts the suit on. Because I'm more into the Flash personality than Barry Allen. Because Barry Allen, anyone can be Barry Allen. It's just you're forensic, you have a different background. You can be Jewish, you can be Latino mixed together.
Yeah.
But when you put the suit on, you have to represent the Lightning. You ride the Lightning. Show us your skills. And this is what I loved about the movie. We saw more of his skills. The tornado, the kicks, the phasing, the speed force, a little bit, the chrono ball. So we had more of the Flash and Barry. So I don't mind, and honestly, if they bring someone that can be both, I'm good with that.
I'd rather them just like, can we, with everything that has happened with both the Barry Allen CW Flash and the Barry Allen movie Flash, excuse me, that we just go ahead and skip forward to Wally West Flash.
Oh like, yes,
just because. That's the most playful one. That's the playful one that everybody loves.
Yes.
And I feel like that's the one that everybody tries to get some of that energy from for their Barry Allen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's like, no, let's go straight to the source of all that playfulness. Let's get that Wally West. Excuse me.
And then, yes, that would be nice to see more Iris and Wally. Yes.
Excuse me. Like the, I feel like the Barry Allen, the younger Barry Allen, reminded me of a Wally West. You know, like, oh, I'm taking a picture for our kids in the future, whatever, you know. That's, to me, he was more of a Wally. And I would just love to see a Wally West get his due, because that's what we saw on the Justice League TV show, or cartoon, for all these years. It was the Wally West. It'd be great.
And you know what? You got a good point, because now I think they might go this way because we have now the changing of gender and also ethnicity.
Right.
Now that we have Iris West as an Afro-American character in CW.
I mean, second.
We are probably going to go with an Afro-American Wally West. You cannot go with a ginger anymore because there's a different continuity, except if they really, really reboot everything. But I think that if they keep it, we will have our very first and own Flash.
I got to put this out there because I saw something a while back. How do you feel about, black actors, black replacing, you know, black superheroes, whatever, changing up from a redhead white kid or female guy, whatever, just a ginger, to a black person. It just out of nowhere, it's just like, it just seemed to always replace the redhead with a black person.
Yeah, you know,
that's just a funny thing.
I don't know. Honestly, we have our own superhero. We have Black Lightning.
Right.
We have Icon. We have
Static. I was just about to say Icon. Yes.
Icon, Static. We have so much that giving us these good characters and switch right. them around, I don't feel like, oh, wow, thank you very much. I just like, okay, you gave us Wally West. You gave us right. Starfire. You gave us... and much more, Jimmy Olsen from CW Smallville.
Yes,
like,
yeah.
You give us so much that, you know what? Let's represent the best we can these characters, mm-hmm. and we'll. If you like it, you like it. If you don't like it, you like it. But right. even though they started with Wallace in Flash Comics as a second Wild Kid Flash, and he's still there. So there's nothing that I can say about, like, you know.
And I mean, honestly, it would kind of fit.
Yes.
Your character. I mean, you know, it's just like, here we are, Wally. So it's like, why not? You know, it's there already. It's just like, just give the man a suit. Give the man a new Wally West suit. That's all. It's like, it's already in your name, so... He's like our imitated life, so just like, let's just do it already, you know.
Give me a suit.
Oh my god, I'm ready. Yes, that's all. We just go ahead, get the man a suit. He already has his name. Give him this man a suit. Man, this is great. I will say thank you. Before we go, I just want to say to let you guys know, July 15th, I got to do this promo. Just July 15th, Saturday, July 15th. Go Ranger Station in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. So all Power Rangers, East Coast Power Rangers event. All your old and favorite old favorite Rangers from the past and the present, from the Zordon era, from the Nickelodeon era to the Netflix era, the Disney era, will all be there, including myself, and a lot of great cosplayers and whatnot. It's going to be a lot of fun. A lot of toy vendors is going to be there. A lot of independent vendors that you might see on Etsy and whatnot is going to be there as well. Just please come out and check it out. It's on the East Coast. It's the only East Coast Power Rangers convention. I have to put that out there. Run by Lady J Cosplay. So please come out and support. That's going to be a fun time. I will be there. I hope you guys come and help out and, you know, have fun with us. Just hang out with the Rangers and, you know, kick back a little bit. That's all. That's all. Just for the day. That's all. That's all you want. And so going back to Mr. Wally West himself, Wallace, thank you so much, man. Like, this has been, I've been waiting for this interview. Like, you know, since I saw you, I was like, I got to talk to this guy. You know, I got to talk to this man. I appreciate you for taking the time out. You know, I didn't want to hold up too much of your time, and I appreciate that you give me this time. You know, to chop it up with you. You know, we got to do more.
Yeah, definitely. Honestly, thank you very much. I love what you're doing. I'll probably hook. I'll hit you up for some more, man, because I love what you're doing. And you know, talking about cosplay comics, and this is my jam too.
Yeah, man. It's. Matter of fact, what do you? I meant to ask you. What do you do outside of cosplay? Like, what? You know, I know your father and husband. Like,
I'm an architect.
God, he has a cool job too. Okay. All right, that's it. I'm done. This guy. I can't do no more with this guy. I am done. This is how creative this man is. He has a creative job. And he does creative stuff on the front side. I'm done. You know, like, I need to do more of my life a little bit. I, you know, I gotta, I gotta build a boat or something. I don't know. I gotta do something else. Thank you. No, thank you so much, man. I really deeply appreciate you for hopping on the BearatNight podcast. Where can people find you, bro? Where can people find you?
They can find me on Instagram, Wallace Morris, or TikTok. I'm really, really, I would say, alive on TikTok. So the Wallace Morris, right. Same name. And YouTube, Replica Cosplay. So you can see mostly my videos and some beautiful project coming on. So Instagram, nice. TikTok, and YouTube.
All right. Y'all heard it here. Y'all heard the man. You know, the Flash himself. You know, there's no other, there's nobody else better than this man right here. Thank you guys for you know, for listening, watching, however you're getting digesting this information right now. Yeah, this is it. I'm about to go because I'm tired. I don't know what else to do now. You know, this guy, he's killed it for me right now. This guy, you made my day, buddy. You killed this. And
thank you.
Like you do on a regular everyday life, man. You, true talent, a class act. Thank you, everybody, for listening. This is Dom. This is the BearatNight podcast. Remember, bear it all, be yourself. Love you guys. Talk to you later. Peace.